Matt Blanchard.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Thanks for having me here today. It's so true. I when you guys get those phone calls, they're truly your customers that they don't know what to do and they need help right now. And getting to rock bottom or the new low. It seems like rock bottom for an addict. There's always something a little deeper. But anyway, thanks for having me out here. I'd like to tell you a little bit about me. So this is my family. This is my youngest son, Brendan, and his girlfriend, Delaney. My oldest son, he's 23. My oldest son in the back there, he's 27, Jaden. My beautiful bride here. We've been boyfriend and girlfriend since I was 15 and she was 16. Yes, she is older than me. I put up with her that long. Wow. Then my little girl who is 25, her husband, Johan in the back, and this handsome fella in the chair. So that's me, that's my life. That's why I'm here, that's what I do. So I also would like to give you guys the opportunity to feel what it's like to be paralyzed. Crazy. So if you would, take your right hand or left hand and put your middle finger down. I know some of us are used to having the middle finger up and the rest down, but for this exercise, middle finger down. And you're gonna put pressure on the table in front of you. And it's important that you get your elbow up in the air. And now raise your thumb off the table, pretty easy. Pinky, easy. Pointer finger, a little more difficult. Now putting pressure on that knuckle, try to lift your ring finger off the table. That's what it feels like to be paralyzed. That's what it's like. I send a message to my feet right now and it just won't move. Crazy. I'm trapped in this thing. I'm trapped in this body. But it's the best thing that's ever happened to me. I also teach anatomy at Dixie State University. Well, it's Utah Tech this week. So, tell you what, man. And the other day, I'm late to class. My wife's my chauffeur everywhere, but I've got this blue handicap placard and it lets me park front row Joe everywhere I go. I don't wait in line at Disneyland, so hey, if anybody, let's go. I pull into my spot, my wife grabs my chair, grab my book bag, put it on my lap, and right in front of me, there's a set of 9 stairs. Now to my left, there's the handicap ramp that I use 3-4 times a day. But I decided today I'm doing the stairs. So my wife's right behind me and she's like, babe, what are you doing? So I'm doing the stairs today. She's like, no. Guys, listen to your wives. Okay. But I get in a wheelie and I'm at the top of these stairs and now all these kids that are late to class, they've stopped what they're doing. They're like, okay, let's see what happens. So I start coming down these stairs. 1, 2, 3, so awesome. 4, 5, I get to the 7th stair and I start to lose my balance. The front end of my wheelchair comes down and I get catapulted out of my chair onto the ground. My wheelchair goes shooting over this way. My book bag's over here. My wife's in the middle of the steps with a look of horror on her face. Like, do I just keep going and pretend like I don't know who this guy is? Like, what? And I gather myself and look over my shoulder at my bride and I'm, babe, I was doing so well. Why did you push me? Yeah, we have a good time. We do. We have a good time. Let's talk about how I ended up in a wheelchair at the top of 9 stairs at Utah Tech University. So January 16th of 2006, I wake up, I'm an electrical contractor at the time. Wake up, go out and jump in my brand new Dodge extended cab, white, brown leather, 30 miles on this bad boy, my dream truck. Jump in there, cruise across town, pick up one of my employees, Brett. He's a 19-year-old punk kid. And Brett jumps in the cab of my truck, my brand new truck, and he shakes the rain off of his hair. And I can see it now. There's rain on my dash and on my stereo, and I'm just looking like, really? Really? And he turns to me, he's like, Matt, put your seatbelt on. Is anybody in here like being told what to do? I don't like being told what to do. So I'm like, look, Brett, I'm in control, I'm driving, don't tell me what to do. And we got on the freeway, started heading up towards Cedar City, and it said that the elevation changes quite a bit, and rain turns to snow. And for the second time, Brett says, Matt, put your seatbelt on. Well, I just ran the St. George Marathon in October. I'm 6'2". I know I look 4'2", but I'm really 6'2". I was 215 pounds at the time. just a mountain of muscle. And I remember thinking that nothing can hurt me. Like I'm built a lot like my man here. And I just like, I'm big, I'm powerful, I'm in control. Don't tell me what to do. Further up the canyon we go. Now we have whiteout conditions. And I am white knuckled on a semi truck. It's tail lights. It gets off the freeway, but I'm late. So I go through that semi truck's tracks. I can't make out where I-15 starts or stops. And for the third time, Brett says, Matt, please put your seatbelt on. And for the third time, I said no. Not a still small voice, not a warm, funny feeling. Someone sitting right next to me asking me to protect myself. And for the third time, I said no. So I lose control of my truck. It goes down into the median between north and southbound traffic. And it launches into the air. And I remember holding on to the steering wheel thinking, oh my hell, we're gonna roll. And it came down on the driver's side cab, ripped my hands from the steering wheel, started its second rotation. Now it's throwing me throughout the cab like a rag doll. And then all the truck rolled three and a quarter times. And it ended up on the passenger door. Everything was black. I was disoriented and confused. And the reason why everything was black and I couldn't see anything is my hips were now covering my face. So I was laying on the passenger door. Brett's buckled in right here. I remember reaching up over my head and grabbing my knees, pulling him back down the floorboards. Now I'm sitting on Brett's lap. And I knew immediately, Brett, I'm paralyzed. Well, emergency crews came down, cut Brett and I out of that truck with the jaws of life, put me in a helicopter, life flighted me to LDS Hospital in Salt Lake City, Utah, where I underwent two surgeries. My back is right now held together with 12 titanium screws, two rods that run the full length of my spine, a plate and a basket. I remember waking up in ICU, and it was dark, and all I wanted to do was sit up. And for whatever reason, I couldn't sit up. I figured they still had me strapped to that gurney. So I'm looking down at my body, and I can't see anything. And the goal was, okay, I'm gonna grab my quads and pull myself up to a sit. So I look at my hand, I've got electrodes, and I've got tubes coming out of this hand. Well, can't use that one. So my left hand's free. So I reached down and I couldn't feel the touch of my own hand. And right then I just started crying. And I thought, you know, I do not want to live a life in a wheelchair. I do not want to live a life of paralysis. If I can't run marathons and hike mountains and do all, I don't want to live. Well, I spent 10 days in ICU. They finally moved me to my own medical room. Now, I grew up in Salt Lake. So people from my neighborhood, my faith, my elementary school, all the way to college. My wife says 400 to 500 people waiting 10 days to give me love, get support. Matt, everything's gonna be okay. But I just wanted this nightmare to be over. I needed to figure out a way to end my life. And I went into a mad depression. Just thinking about all the things I couldn't do anymore. And I got focused on that and I just started spiraling down, just spiraling. And I remember as people would come into my room, these 400 or 500 people who had waited, as they would come into my room during visiting hours, I lay in my bed. I had a brace that went from my hips to just under my shoulder blades. I wouldn't open my eyes for anybody. I wouldn't acknowledge anybody. And at the end of the day, when visiting hours were over, everybody had left my room, all but one person, that's my old man. And I wouldn't even open my eyes or acknowledge my dad. But he grabbed a chair and he pulled it over to the side of my bed and I'm laying there. And he said something that changed my life. He says, Matt, you can quit. I mean, he saw that whole day. Matt, you can quit. We can all quit. But do you have it in you to dig in, dig deep, and get it done? Dig in, dig deep, and get it done. And he left the room. So I'm wrestling with my dad's words all night long. Dig in. Life in a wheelchair. dig deep. Paralysis. Get it done. And what was I gonna get done? I didn't know what I was gonna do. All I wanted to do was walk. So you know what? That's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna walk. I'm Matt Blanchard. Paralysis doesn't have anything on me. So the following morning, my occupational therapist comes bouncing into my room, Casey Mitchell. He's like, Matt, what do you wanna do today? I'm like, yo, Casey, I wanna walk. He's like, okay, we'll walk. But first I want you to get your socks on. And I laughed. My socks on, for real? He's like, yeah, you get your socks on and we'll walk. The reason why I couldn't sit up in ICU is because I didn't know how to anymore. So I broke my spine about 2 inches above my belly button. So I'd lost my abs. I'd lost everything below the waist. That 6'2" powerful man, I didn't know what I was. I was so scared of everything. Your clients are scared. They're scared. Well, Casey throws me a pair of socks, starts to leave the room. I'm like, yo, Casey, where are you going? I just gotta get these socks on. We're gonna walk, right? He's like, yeah, get your socks on. I'll be right back. So I'm laying there in my hospital bed, and I've got that brace. Oh, goodness. Now, to be able to take my feet off my footrest and hold my trunk up, 18 months of therapy every day, 7 days a week, every single day. So I'm laying there in bed, I've got my socks here, and I'm looking down and I can't even see the feet that I'm supposed to get these socks on. So I start pulling up my legs and they're so heavy, so muscular, so cold, so cold. And I get frustrated, I'm sweating, 40 minutes has gone by, no socks on. So what helps when you get frustrated? You cuss, right? Cuss. So I start cussing, oh, get my leg up here. People start coming in my room. Hey, are you okay? I'm like, get my socks on. Leave me alone, get my socks on. My socks on. Well, I think 50 minutes had gone by. Casey comes walking into the room. I am an exhausted mess. There's this outline of sweat on my bed. Got my socks here, and he says, Matt, do you want help? You want help getting your socks on? What do you think I said? No, no, hell no. Who needs help getting their socks on? We all need help getting our socks on. My socks are just a little different than your socks. So whatever your goal is, we all have to get our socks on first. And if we can do this together as a team, can we do it on our own? Yeah. But is it gonna take you an hour and a half to get your socks on? Or are you gonna ask my man here, yo, bro, will you come and help me get my socks on because we got things to do today? So what are your socks? What do your socks look like? Is that your first phone call? Is that, how did your day go? Do you have your affirmations? I wake up every morning, I have my affirmations, I have my worthy goal, I do my meditation, and I'm ready to go. And then I come and get to meet brand new people, and life's good. So I said to Casey, I don't need help getting my socks on. Don't need help. So he starts to leave the room again, and I kid you not, he throws me a lasso. It's from a hip kit. I don't know if anybody's medical here, but it's a lasso. So now I'm laying in bed, got socks in this hand, lasso in this hand, and I spent the next 10 minutes trying to lasso a foot that I can't see, right? And just, come on, man, come on. Finally, now remember, I am gone mentally. I finally rope my right foot and I pull it up to me and I start to have a conversation with my foot. I'm like, really, dude? Like, it's been an hour, 5 minutes. We're gonna walk and all we gotta do is get our socks on, get on my team, or get out of my way. Put my sock on, throw it down at the end of the bed. Whew, take a deep breath. And I rope my left foot first time. And I pull that foot up to me and I start commending it on the good job it just did. Well done, well done, good job. And I pull my sock up an hour and 10 minutes, throw that foot down to the end of the bed. Casey comes walking into the room. He'd been watching the entire time. Matt, you got your socks on. Let's go. Let's go walk. Casey, I got my socks on, bro. I got my socks on. But this went on day after day. Matt, what do you want to do today? I want to walk. All right. First, let's get our socks on. So we did this for 3 months, to where I was able to get my socks on and my sweatpants on in a record 17 minutes. One decision to not click my seatbelt. I'm in a wheelchair today because of pride and arrogance. There it is right there. Pride and arrogance. Don't let pride and arrogance paralyze you. Be open to others. Ask for help. Why is it so hard to ask for help? Offer help. Offer it without even being asked. Here's the thing. You guys all offer me help every day. Bet money I don't go over to that door and somebody gets up and gets that door for me. I can't even tell you the last time I got a door. Anywhere I go, I smile. See? And the world smiles back. Everywhere I go. Why am I in such a good mood? Why do I have... Because everybody sees my challenge. And you are all going through your thing. I can't see your thing. Don't suffer in silence. Don't suffer in silence. Reach out. It's gentle is strong. It's not a weakness to ask for help or just go and offer your help. Well, 3 months has gone by. All Matt Blanchard wants to do is walk. That's what he's going to do. I want to walk. And on this particular morning, my surgeon comes in with Casey. Now, my surgeon is the same surgeon. His name is Dr. Rich. Same guy that does all Tiger Woods stuff. Like, this guy is legit. He knows what's up. He put me back together. Amazing. And he says, Mr. Blanchard, I understand you want to walk. And I'm like, no, you got it wrong. I'm going to walk. He's like, listen, you suffered a very severe spinal cord injury. And I've treated thousands of spinal cord injuries just like yours throughout my career. It would be a waste of my staff's time and a waste of your energy to focus on walking. Become independent in your wheelchair. And he left the room. He's a surgeon. He doesn't really have a whole lot of bedside manner, right? Now Casey and I are looking at each other like, oh my lands, that just happened. I'm like, Casey, he's telling me I'm never gonna walk again. So I did something, saved my life. I'd been labeled so my medical chart says I am a T12 complete spinal cord injury. And T12 complete spinal cord injuries do not walk. He'd labeled me, put me on a shelf, and we've all been labeled something. Good labels, bad labels, and everything in between. I chose not to wear that label. It's a choice. So I got rid of all of the doctors, therapists, family and friends that said, Matt, you're paralyzed. You're gonna be in a chair the rest of your life. And I surrounded myself with people who thought maybe with the right attitude and the right effort. And those two things are something that you have complete control of the rest of your life. Whether you're locked in a prison cell or the president of the United States, you have control of your attitude and your effort. Always, 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 always. I can't make you happy. You can't make me happy. That's on me. And it's not my job. You know, my job is to be a better version of myself tomorrow or today than I was yesterday. And today I'm winning. Today I'm winning. I don't win every day, but today I'm winning. So we went to work. And I did therapy, physical therapy, for 15 years. Because some goals take a long time. And this is what that looked like. I try to see, but I'm blinded by the white light. I can't remember how, I can't remember why I'm lying here tonight. And I can't stand the pain, and I can't make it go away. No, I can't stand the pain.
screaming. I try to make a sound, but no one hears me. I'm slipping off the edge. I'm hanging by a thread. I wanna start this over again. So I try to hold on to a time when nothing mattered and I can't explain what happened and I can't erase the things that I've done.
You feel like a candle in a hurricane, just like a picture with a broken frame, alone and helpless, like you've lost your fight. But you'll be alright, you'll be alright. 'Cause when push comes to shove, you taste what you're made of. You might bend till you break, 'cause it's all
So I regained the ability to walk with forearm crutches. Put my wheelchair away. Every time I'd walk, I'd get stronger. And it was difficult. It was hard. It was slow. I was really slow. But I'd use my wheelchair to get around town, around the house. I'm in my forearm crutches. And I at my best, with one single point cane, I was able to walk about 40 yards. And man, we are cooking. We're doing good. But pushing my body, this broken body, that hard every single day came at a price. And that price was pain. And how do physicians deal with pain? Medication. So growing up, I was that squeaky clean kid, man. I was the DD all the time and proud of that fact. I get hurt and I get introduced to a drug called OxyContin. And boy, all I know is that when I take this drug, I can go hard in therapies, man. I can push this thing hard, push this vessel hard. So they gave me OxyContin. I went home on Oxy 10s and Lortab 10s. So the Lortab 10s were for my breakthrough pain, when I just couldn't handle whatever that pain was. Well, after a year, those no longer worked. So I went from Oxy 10s to Oxy 30s three times a day, and Lortab 10s to Perc 10s, and for another year. Then we went to fentanyl patches. Then we went to Oxy 80s. Then we went to Roxycontin. I have done every drug under the sun. And I became an addict. And I wanted to quit so many times. And on my own, I tried. The longest I made it on my own was 18 hours. Before that drug just took me back. I hated that it had so much power over me that literally my day started and ended with OxyContin and Roxy's. At my peak of abuse, I was taking 390 milligrams a day. So I was taking 480 pills every 2 weeks. Now, these were prescribed by my physician. I used the same physician. I used the same pharmacy. So they saw my track record. And then I show x-rays to anybody, and they're like, oh, hell yeah, that guy's in pain, for sure. That I was taking opiates to deal with my emotional pain, not my physical pain. I didn't like the fact that after 15 years, I was still in a wheelchair. So I would take these drugs to escape. And my regimen was the Oxy 80 in the morning and then five Roxys. I wake up, wait for that to sink in, and you can just feel that, just mm-hmm. I get up, get in my wheelchair, go to therapy. After therapy, I would take another Oxy, five more Roxys. Well, after so many years of doing this, my little girl, who was 12 years old at the time, she comes to therapy with my wife. And I get done with therapy, take my Roxy, take my Oxys, and I'm in the front seat, just snowed. And my little girl asked my wife, hey mom, what are all those pills that dad takes? And for whatever reason, I heard this. Are they really gonna kill him? And right there in a state of being high, I got my phone out and called my doctor. I'm like, hey, Dr. Clark, I've been lying to you for years. I've been taking my opiates to deal with my emotional pain because I do not like being paralyzed. I don't like being in a wheelchair. I'm done. I'm not doing this anymore. He's like, okay, Matt, okay, but hold on. You're on 390 milligrams a day. We're gonna need to get you on Suboxone or Methadone to deal with your withdrawals. Now, I didn't know what Suboxone and Methadone were. So I'm like, yo, what are they? He's like, well, we use Suboxone and Methadone for heroin addicts when they come off. I'm not a heroin addict. I don't need Suboxone or Methadone. I'm going cold turkey, man. Click. So my dad took a leave of absence from work. My brother came up from California. I'd made the decision to get clean. My whole family knew I had a drug problem. I was that guy that as soon as I came into anybody's house, hey, I got to use the bathroom. I got to go to the bathroom. You know, let's go through the medicine cabinet, see what's there. So if there's one thing I would like you to take away today is that I went through addiction. I'm not an addict. And I think with the TMS, people are going through depression. They're not depression. So I'm not depressed. I'm going through depression. And to separate that. So it's not like a label on them. They're going through this. Like, this is temporary. We can help you. We can help you. So you're not depressed, you're going through depression. I'm not an addict, I went through addiction. Well, I decided to get clean. The first day, I'm okay. I've got opiates in my system. I'm nervous, I'm anxious, and I just told my doctor, don't give me more meds. It's so scary. And I didn't sleep that night. Next morning, I'm just rocking on the couch. So what would happen is my older brother would stay with me at nighttime. My dad would stay up with me during the day. And I was just rocking on the couch because when you're withdrawing, going through withdrawals, it literally feels like bugs are under your skin. You're literally going crazy, nuts. When I was growing up, there was a commercial where they'd take a frying pan and get this frying pan just cooking hot, and they'd have an egg. And they said, this is your brain with the egg, and crack it in that frying pan, and now it's just popping. And they said, this is your brain on drugs. That's false. That's your brain coming off drugs. That's something else. So I get through that day. The second day, I'm just sick, and I don't know what to do with myself. I'm biting everybody. I'm just barking at everybody, saying horrible things. Give me a pill, this all goes away. You don't love me. Give me a pill. Don't sleep that second day. The third day, I spent the whole day on the shower floor. In vomit, in diarrhea. It horrible. My wife standing over me trying to control the temperature of the water as I'm just shivering. As I yelled obscenities at her. She'd have enough and she'd leave the room. My dad would come in. And I'd tear him up till he would leave the room. I even did this with my kids who were 10, 12, and 14 at the time. Well, after a week, everything's straight. Well, I'm going nuts, and I need my family to give me something. I haven't slept in 3 days. The toxins leave my system. I smell like sulfur, like rancid urine. And finally, they call my doctor, Dr. Clark. Like, you need to get over here. He's going nuts. I still have scars from scratching myself, pulling hair out, punching holes in walls. See, what was not cool is my dad took my wheelchair away. That's what he did. So the only thing I could do is army crawl around the house and try to bite his kneecaps. That's the worst I could do. And so Dr. Clark's finally comes to my house. I'm sitting on my bed, and I remember thinking as he came through my door, oh my lands, I'm gonna get an oxy. They hear me. So I'm sitting on my bed, and yo, Dr. Clark, listen, I still wanna be clean. It's been 3 days, but I just need one oxy, just one oxy. I didn't know it was gonna be like this, and I'm trying to manipulate the situation. And he says, hey, I'm not here to give you an oxy. So I start crying. Doctor, please give me a pill. I stink. And he's like, yep, I know, I can smell you. So I raise my voice. Dr. Clark, give me a bleepity bleeping pill. And he matches my level. He's like, Matt, you're acting like an addict. Now this is my day one. Since I got hurt, this is my day one doctor. I love him. He's saved my life many times. What he did was gave me a drug called Seroquel. And he gave me 4 boxes of Seroquel. And he said, look, take one of these pills at night and I promise you, you'll sleep. I'm like, okay, cool. So he leaves the room to go out to talk to my family. And I opened all 4 of those boxes and took all of that Seroquel, all of it. My blood pressure drops, my heartbeat, and I OD on Seroquel. Crazy. Well, what's that? Oh, yes. Let me share with you my definition of addiction. Now, it's not like Webster's, but we're close. So addiction is compulsive behavior with short-term benefits and long-term destruction. Addiction is compulsive behavior, gotta have it. With short-term benefits, I got it. And long-term destruction. Where do I go from here? And that's where your clients are coming from. If you're getting a phone call, it's so true what Robert said. If you're getting a phone call, do you know what it takes to make that phone call? It takes a lot. And like the car salesman that gets back to you instantly, that's what I needed. That's what I needed. I was finally to a point where I didn't know where to go. I didn't know what to do, and I reached out, and my family and my doctor were there immediately. Now, TMS didn't exist back in 06 when I was going through all this garbage. Now, I have friends that have done this, and all 3 of them rave about it. They rave about it. So you've got a product that everybody needs. If you're going through through addiction or depression, we've got the answer. So there's the first thing. So when I'm a public speaker, you need to hear me. I know this. You need to hear my message. Why? Because I inspire and I motivate and give you a different perspective on life. TMS, same thing, will give you a different perspective on life. Well, my little girl, who was 12 at the time, she shared her journal entries with me about 6 years ago. And her first journal entry reads this. Today, my dad is going off all of his pills. Dig in, dig deep, get it done. Big smiley face. Day 2, my dad is mean. He says mean things to my mom. He says mean things to my grandpa. This is all over pills. I don't understand. Day 3, my dad is as sick as a dog. Now, this is the day I spent the day on the shower floor. He can't talk. He can't sit up. I'm really worried. Now, day 4 is the day I took all the Seroquel. And I have absolutely no recollection of day 4. Zero. But her journal entry reads this. Today's the first day that I saw my grandpa cry. I want somebody to give my dad back all his pills so he can be normal again. And then in big capital letters, my dad scares me. See, dad's not supposed to scare their children. He's supposed to be there to love, support, protect. And opiates had turned me into something I was not proud of. It turned me into a monster. You know, and when she shared these journal entries with me, let's see, she's 25 today, so she was right around 20 years old. And, you know, I'm crying at this point, because you don't realize the effect you have on your kids and anybody else, because it's just you. It's all about me. It's about my depression. It's about my need. You don't understand my pain. Who are you to say I'm not in pain and I don't need these things? Well, she gave me just a big hug, big embrace, and we cried. We cried together. Now, it's a physiological fact that energy can be transferred through human touch. And we've all done this our whole lives. Somebody's feeling down, you give them a hug, right? You're gonna bring them up, you gotta bring them up. So, I mean, like, here we go. Basketball games, right? High fives, right? Fist bumps. And if my man were over here, pats on the butt, right? Because we're at a basketball game. Now, you can't do that. Don't do that in your companies. Don't do it. But how do you give a high five? Maybe an email. Hey, I appreciate what you've done, your team, where you're going. Your energy's amazing. A fist bump. Maybe a text message. Yo, you look nice today. Your shoes are on point. I haven't seen your shoes yet, bro, but if they match your shirt. So you're on point, right? You're on point. So there's your fist bump, your smack on the butt. I know we better stay away from smacks on the butt, but it's a fact, right? Even talking about it, the energy's raised in this room. So on your teams that you're building, what kind of culture do you want? Do you want the culture of that when Robert comes through that door, you're like, oh crap, boss is here? Or do we want, my man, Robert, what's up? Yes, let me tell you about what's going on. Let's tell you where we're going, what we're doing. So establish a culture, that culture of high fives, fist bumps, and smacks on the butt. Get that culture going. Be unique. And that will transfer over to your phone calls that you're receiving and giving. The energy, you can tell the energy. You call me, you talk to me on the phone, and you're down, we're going to end the call laughing. Promise. Because I'm going to tell you some funny things about me or whatever, make fun of myself, whatever. But I'm going to raise the energy. That's what I do. That's my purpose. So there's another word, and some of you may be familiar with this. The word is Ubuntu. Anybody familiar with Ubuntu? Mm-hmm, my man. So U-B-U-N-T-U. It's an African word. And what it means is it's the essence of being human. I am because we are. I am because we are. When I was going through addiction, I'm going through addiction because we are going through addiction. And it doesn't mean just the person going through addiction or just the person going through depression. Think of all the other people that are dealing with depression, like my bride here. I didn't want to live. How does that make her feel? And my kids feel. So depression is much bigger than just your client calling. And when, just listen. Like Robert said, Dr. Clark, he says, you know, Matt, most of my day is just listening because nobody wants to listen anymore. Everybody wants to talk about what's going on. Just listen. And up, bet money you don't have your client. Bet money. If instead of, hey, where are you at with insurance? Hey, where are you at with money? You're like, tell me more about that. Well, you know, my dad passed away and la-di-da-di-da. Tell me more about that. How are you feeling about it? How are you dealing? Ask questions. Get them talking. Now you've established a relationship and you've got them because I know you care about me because you've just listened to me. I don't feel like you're after my money. I don't feel like you're after you. You've listened, you've heard me, you've dealt with other patients, and you say, I can help you. For real, you can help me? For real. I can help you. Done and done. Done and done. So Ubuntu, the essence of being human, I am because we are. We got Mowgli, right? Mowgli, the Jungle Book, born into a pack of wolves. What does Mowgli think he is? A wolf, right? So we're not born and know how to be a father or a husband, or we learn by watching other people and interacting with other people. So I can only be the best version of me by helping you become the best version of you. It's true. It's a fact. It's a fact that you are the average of the five people you spend the most time with. Fact. When I was an addict, I hung around with addicts. NBA players, they hang around other NBA players. Doctors hang around doctors. Lawyers with lawyers. So if you want to be a millionaire, who better you start hanging out with? Millionaires. So I was in a room speaking to a bunch of billionaires. And the question was asked, Matt, why are you only a millionaire? Why aren't you a billionaire? And I started giving them all the reasons. Well, I don't have enough real estate and stocks and this, that, and the other. And the guy's like, no, I'll tell you why you're not a billionaire. Because you think like a millionaire. Okay, so tell me how to become a billionaire. This is coming from billionaires. Help other people become millionaires, and by default, you'll be a billionaire. It's not about us. It's not about me, it's about us. If I can help you in any way, shape, or form, the answer is yes. The answer is yes. Because it's gonna make me a better person. So it's not about you, it's about Ubuntu. It's about being better today than you were yesterday. And if that's, listen, 1% better each day, that's a lot. Because at the end of the year, you're 360% better. Anybody's gonna take that, right? There's gonna be steps forward, there's gonna be falling back. I'm living in Ubuntu, I'm living my best life, you guys. Things are going good. I'm walking with one single point cane. My little girl, she's 25, she's getting married September 25th of 2021, okay? So what was it, 2 years ago? September 25th, 2021. And what do fathers do with their daughters? Walk them down the aisle, you bet. And she didn't want me walking with a single point cane because she thought I was gonna get on her dress and maybe I'd go down, and I'm like, okay, sweets. So we did with forearm crutches, and we practiced, and we got to the point where she's like, okay, we can do this, we can do this. Then this happened.
And
February 12th, 7 years before, or sorry, 7 months before my little girl's getting married, I'm heading down, I'm on I-15, and a drunk driver in a Chrysler 300 crosses the median and hits me head on at 120 miles an hour. I'm in my pickup truck going 80 miles the other way, so a 200 mile an hour impact, 200 mile. I'm not supposed to be here. Like, I paid for the game, and I'm in triple overtime. Like, every breath, every conversation is so precious to me. Living in the moment, that's where I'm at now. That's where I'm at. I live in the moment. Well, so I'm trapped in that truck again. I get cut out of my truck again. I suffer spinal fractures again. I'm paralyzed. Again, those 15 years, gone. Guess who's not walking their little girl down the aisle? Me. And that's okay. Because life happens for me, not to me. And it's my job to understand, why is this happening? what's the lesson to be learned so I can get this off my plate and get going? But if I continue to use that as a block, like life's not fair, well, guess what? You're right, life's not fair, and it's never gonna be fair. But I can tell you that everything that's happened to me in my life has happened for me. Paralysis, I hate it with every fiber of my being. And to say you hate something, you have to have a very intimate relationship with that something that you hate. And I hate paralysis. And it's the best thing that's ever happened to me. The best thing that's ever happened to my family. It's allowed me to become the person I was always meant to be. So what paralyzes you? What's on your plate right now that you're dealing with by yourself that nobody else can see, and you don't need help getting your damn socks on, because who needs help getting their socks on? So you're gonna struggle in silence. Don't, why do that? Don't do that. Don't. Reach out to people. Say, I'm struggling. What do you think about this? Have you been here before? Da 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 da. And learn the lesson and get it by and get going again. So my little girl getting married, and which was so awesome. You met my family in the beginning. My oldest son was able to walk her down the aisle to me. Awesome. Handed her off to me, and we did a little twirl. It was just she and I for a minute, and handed her off to her husband, who I absolutely love and adore. And life's good. But now we got the daddy-daughter dance, right? How does that look? So nobody knew. There was me, Brooklyn, her husband, and the wedding coordinator. That's it. So the daddy-daughter dance, hey, dad, time to do the daddy-daughter dance. And this is what the daddy-daughter dance looked like.
Dance for a while. Heaven can wait, we're only watching the skies. Hoping for the best but expecting the worst. Are you gonna drop the bomb or not? Let us die young or let us live forever. We don't have the power but we never say never. Sitting in a sandpit, life is a short trip. The music's for the sad man. Forever young, I wanna be forever.
Tomorrow's, but we ain't even thinking that far. You know what I mean?
So we live. Special day, and that special day, and anybody else who was able to witness that and how it affected them, because life happens for us. It really does. Life happens for us. I'm grateful for my challenges. I really am. I'm grateful for my challenges. Is life hard? Yeah. Is my life as hard as y'all's? I don't know. The world smiles at me. People get the cheese. I can't reach the cheese at the supermarket. They get me the cheese. They get the door for me. So my struggle is, my load is lightened daily. You watch me throughout the weekend. And how many people go out of their way because my life's so hard? It's not. Y'all make it easier, but you guys are going through some stuff. You're going through some stuff. I get it. Everybody's going through some stuff. Don't do it alone. My man Robert, I would call him and talk to him about anything. Anything. Call and talk to him. Call and talk to him. Guess what he's gonna do? He's gonna listen. And pull more out so he has a better understanding so that he can help you. Same with your clients. Same with your potential clients. So if there's a 10-minute window, then fill that 10-minute window and bet you're not fulfilled by the conversation. Bet you're not fulfilled. And bet that you don't get that client because that client knows you care. And you've taken 10 minutes to try to figure out how can I help you, because I know I can help you. That's powerful. That's powerful. For someone who's rock bottom, who doesn't know what to do, to have somebody say, I can help you. Give me your hand. Yep, let's go. Let's do it. So there's something that we've all done in our lives over and over and over and failed at over and over and over again. And this particular thing happened right around in between 9 months of age and, well, I don't know, let's say 12 months. Do anybody know what I'm talking about? Walking, you bet. So you crawl over to the coffee table because you've got a goal to walk. I still have a goal to walk. Even though it's been taken from me twice, there's no quitting me. There's no quit. I don't suffer from depression. I went through depression. I don't suffer from addiction. I went through addiction. That's not my label. I will not be labeled depressed or an addict. I went through that with a lot of help. I mean a lot of help. Now, do I think of an OxyContin daily? Yeah. And in that second accident, so my back was broken again, my femur was broken, my hip was broken. And as they were cutting me out and putting me on the gurney, my bottom half was so broken that it was like Gumby. It was crazy to see, crazy. And I'm sitting there watching the whole thing happen. And I remember thinking, I am so grateful I'm paralyzed, because I couldn't feel any of it. My tib fib on this leg had been compound fractured, bones were sticking out, blood. I remember grabbing this femur, because this femur's straight, and my leg was just like jello, and bringing it back over. And I remember thinking, I am so grateful that I'm paralyzed. Because they cut me out, put me in the helicopter, and I spent the next year in the hospital in St. George. Because I had to have my hip replaced and external fixators. So I was so broken, they had bars to try to keep my bones together so they would grow together, because I was so messed up. And I remember thinking, I don't want to live. And this was February 12th of 2021. I knew what was in front of me. I'd been clean for 8 years. On the life flight, they gave me Dilaudid. And as soon as they pushed that drug, I was just like, oh, there you are. And instantly, I was hooked again. Instantly. September 18th of this year marked my 1 year of being clean. So I've been clean for a year. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. I know that that opiates, painkillers, they have control of me. So she is control of anything that I might become addicted to. Because I know I just don't have the strength, because I just want, okay, an addict's mindset is one more. Just one more, just one more. Because you're always chasing that high. One more, then you're short, and then you're anxious, and then, it's horrible. The cycle's horrible. But I remember telling my wife, I'm like, babe, I've got all of these surgeries ahead of me. And I'm talking surgery after surgery after surgery. And I didn't care if I lived or died through these surgeries. I'd lost sight of my goal. I'd lost sight of who I was. But I'd surrounded myself with people who thought maybe, with the right attitude and effort. And so when I wasn't strong enough, and I'd lost sight of who I was, and I had my wife and my family and my friends who came around me and picked me up until I could stand on my own, walk on my own. Now, as you walked over or crawled over to the coffee table, and you conk your head because goals hurt. You're crying and you're wobbly. And what's your name, my man?
Jamal.
So Jamal at 9 months of age, you know, his head was a lot bigger than his body. Okay. And when he took a step, he took a header, right on the carpet. Now you got an abrasion and you're crying and you got a goosebump. You turned right back around and went over to the dang coffee table again. Even though it hurt. Because you had a goal to walk. And you achieved that goal, yeah? Everybody in this room achieved that goal. So why at 12 months of age did you never quit? Because you didn't freaking know how to quit. You didn't know how to quit. Somewhere along the line, society says it's okay to fail. Everybody's gonna get a trophy. Everybody for participation, hey, yo. And failure was accepted at some point. So if failure is a learned behavior, we can certainly unlearn it. Certainly unlearn it. Get a goal. Surround yourself with people who give you the best opportunity to be successful, your teams. And it all starts with you. It all starts with your energy. As soon as you walk into your offices or whatever, it all starts with y'all. Y'all know I've come home from work, had a bad day, my wife's laughing and joking with the kids, and I wreck their day right then, just like that. I'm sure we've all done that. You go into a room, I'm not about this, I've had a hard day. Guess what? You're gonna have a hard day now. So if we can transfer that kind of energy, then we certainly can come in hippity hopping and hey, yo, let's go. What's our goal today? How many calls are we gonna make? How long are our calls gonna be? What's the verbiage? Pull more out. And how many clients? Because you're helping people. They need what you're providing. But first, we need to understand where they're at. And boy, if they've made that call, swear to you, that's a scary call. That's a desperation at the end of your rope. I don't know what to do. And you'll save a life with 10 minutes. You will save a life with 10 minutes. Create a culture of positivity, of high fives, fist bumps, and smacks on the butt. Live in Ubuntu. It's not about you. It's about us. We can only have the best sales team. We can only have the best opportunity to be successful by the five people we spend the most time with, and go to work. Any negative criticizing people, they gotta go. I had to cut my mom and my dad out in the beginning because I'm their kid. Even though I was 30 years old, my mom wanted to coddle me. My dad wanted to get my coffee mugs for me. And that would have been the worst thing I could have done. Grind. Find joy in the grind. You're not getting away from the grind. Find joy in the grind. All right, we're gonna see how this goes. Now, I was told it would be a waste of my time, the therapist's time, and a waste of my effort to focus on walking, become independent in your wheelchair. And if you can't see me, go ahead and stand up. Because T12 complete spinal cord injuries do not walk. That's just the way it is. It's impossible. It's impossible. Become independent in your wheelchair. Oh, thank you. Thank you. I want you guys to know that everything is impossible. Everything is impossible until it's not. Anybody who ever tried to climb Mount Everest was told, anybody who's ever tried died. It's impossible. And now how many people have summited Mount Everest? Back in the 70s and 80s, it was impossible to break a 5-minute mile. We're a sub 4 mile now. Everything's impossible until it's not. So what's your impossible thing? If people say, yo, that's a compliment. Somebody tells you that's impossible, that's a compliment. Watch me. I'm gonna surround myself with people that give me the best opportunity to be successful, and I'm gonna go to work. So I challenge you, dig in, dig deep, and get it done. Thanks for letting me come speak to you. Robert, will you come over here before me, brother? Whew, will you just grab my chair and put it behind me? Thank you so very much. Oh, there it is. Whew.